To the site plan approval that was in place as opposed to a brand new one. It is a little less dense, if you will. Typically your lab and life science companies are a little bit more spread out. They have fewer people working per square foot in the space. So whereas we had a facility of 186,000 previously and upwards of around 600 parking spaces, I got that math right, before, we are now at 100, well, we're now looking at 100,000 square feet and 250 spaces, so about 2.5 per thousand as opposed to three or more 3.1 spaces per thousand that were approved before. So it's lower parking, less parking demand for the facility. And what I can do is, if allowable, Tony, I can share my screen so
like me to drive and so you can focus on the presentation, or are you okay?
Actually, that'd be great. Do you have the color plan available?
I thought you'd ask. Yes.
Yeah, perfect.
All right, one
more. Even better. Then I will get out of this. So Will will share the site plan, give you guys an overview of the project.
And you see the colored site plan.
Yeah, we got it.
Great.
So on the bottom of the plan, actually, just it's a little bit odd configuration, but off the bottom of the view would be Middlesex Turnpike running across the bottom of the screen. And what you see with some cars parked in a building right at the bottom edge, is the FW website that exists today. And just to the right of that is Bedford Woods Site Drive, which also exists today. And that provides access as you continue further up the page, which is a little bit to the sort of south and west, as Bedford Woods Site Drive goes. That will get you to RSA. So it's an undeveloped piece of land in there where the building would be 100,000 square feet. Will can sort of outline that with the parking on either side of the building. As I mentioned, 250 parking spaces. There's a loading area off the sort of southeasterly end. And they do have some space for utilities in the area that Will is highlighting right now. Being again a lab type building, they do have some pretty significant utility space. They will have some heavy air change HVAC units, some of which will be on the ground, some of the equipment will be on the roof, and it requires, you know, a lot of fresh air for this type of use, as well as backup generators and things of that nature. That whole area will be fenced in. There is circulation around the entirety of the site. All the utilities that are needed already exist in Bedford Woods Site Drive. Will could probably give you a quick overview on the drainage and how that works. And all of this is very much consistent with what was previously designed and permitted, and it works in conjunction with that. Maybe just using the color picture, Will, you can sort of outline the drainage system.
Sure, thanks, Scott. So as Scott mentioned, as part of that original construction in the early 2000s, when lots 3 and 4 were constructed north of this view. Gutierrez Company also installed and constructed all the detention basins sized for the full build out of Bedford Woods. So you can kind of see here in the aerial imagery, there's several along Bedford Woods Drive, one here and one down here, slightly out of view. And then one here that receives runoff from both the full previously approved Bedford Woods design, as well as some flow from the FW website. There, in addition, and that was negotiated with the town with the desire of having those basins fully vegetated as they receive stormwater runoff from the active construction site to obviously greatly help with removal of sediment and keep sediment out of the wetlands that are located around the perimeter of the property. So one detention basin was actually built approximately right here in anticipation of receiving the lot one rooftop. As we developed site layout options for this project, we realized this area was restrictive for parking. So we proposed to shift that basin to right here. So this basin will be relocated and receive rooftop runoff only, which is considered clean. The rest of the project will, as part of this detention basin installation, there was a manhole constructed here with, in generally this area, with stubs for future connection. So generally, there's a drainage divide somewhere in here. Generally, this back parking lot and the loading area is routed to this existing detention basin here. And this front area here and a portion of these parking stalls here will be routed around this basin and connect to a drainage stub that was left outside of the Bedford Woods Drive work. And that will actually enter this southern detention basin right here. I think that covers everything. And this detention basin here has adequate size for not only the Ultragenics Phase 1 project, but also any future expansion they're contemplating on Lot 1, and has full capacity for development on, I'd say, half of Lot 2 is intended to drain this way into this existing basin.
Right. And so just to piggyback on what Will was just saying, so all of Bedford Woods' drainage system was all designed and fully constructed for not just the two buildings that have been completed and occupied, but also to accommodate the future two lots. One here, this is lot one for Ultragenics, as well as the future expansion and the future lot two. So it was all built, including building a detention basin essentially in the woods, which we're now looking to basically fill in and move over, just so we can accommodate the layout preferred by Ultragenics. One of the benefits of this layout is it does present a nice facade along Bedford Woods site drive. So the front facade is going to be visible and gives a nice entrance corner as you come up the site drive to where people approaching the property would come. So this is all the block of the building is different shape than was previously approved, but essentially the building is in roughly the same general location as was previously planned and approved. And so now we're changing the configuration, but we still maintained the circulation around the building, the site driveway off of the Bedford Woods site drive at the top of the screen, or towards the southwest edge of it, will act as a shared driveway for future development. And Will, if you pull up the site plans themselves and go to the sort of future build.
Not only is the building footprint very similar, but the building finished floor elevation is identical of 162. Just to help with earthwork and tying in all the gravity utilities like sewer, drainage, everything, tying into the stubs along Bedford Woods Drive, we kept the finished floor elevation the same.
Right. And so what we included in the package here in C-122, although we're not seeking approval for the full development, we're showing how the proposed current phase of the project, which is this Ultragenics building, phase one building, they have plans for what amounts to a more office lab type addition off the side of the building. That would be their expansion, which would extend the parking lot down to the south and east from where it currently sits. And then what you see just above that is the previously approved lot two building in its original configuration. So that is for the most part unchanged from what was previously approved. So that gives you an idea of how this fits in the overall plan and development plan. And this plan actually just shows you can see how Bedford Woods Site Drive wraps around in a circular motion. And you can see just the tips of what is building three and building four, which are the existing buildings that are occupied today by RSA Security. So we just highlight that to show how it fits in the overall plan and how it's consistent. The former layout for lot one, again, had a different building shape, but it was in the roughly the same location, and as Will mentioned, the same exact finished floor, so that the grading works out in a very similar, comparable way. The building area itself, the footprint, is a little bit larger than the previously planned building, but as a result, the parking areas are a little bit smaller because, again, the parking need and demand is not quite as high for a lab use as it is for the office use. So even projecting out at the full build of lot one, you would have more building area and less parking, more building footprint, but the same building area, just to give you an idea there. And then just to extend all the way back around to where you started, Mr. Chair, with the A&R plan. Will, if you could, do you have that handy as well?
That's a little slow, but I have it here.
Okay. So as that comes up on the screen, this is oriented a little bit differently, so that Middlesex Turnpike now is on the right side of the page, and the FW Webb site is also towards the right, tucked in there, and it doesn't show the existing improvements of the site drive and the like. This area, these four lots, each building was on a separate lot, lots three and four, which were already constructed. Lots one and two did not meet the current zoning requirements that were put in place. I think, again, it was about 4 years ago when the zoning was changed for the industrial B district. And so what we have done is modified the lot layout between lots one and two. Lot one, again, being where we're currently looking to construct for Ultragenics. Lot one is being reconfigured a little bit, and lot two, so that they meet the current zoning requirements, including frontage. Setbacks are not an issue. Frontage, lot minimum lot width, and there's a number of other calculations involved in terms of lot area within 500 feet and the likes of its frontage. So these lots now comply, and that's the reason for the A&R. But overall, the land area doesn't change. There were two lots before. There would be two lots in the future. We're just really just putting the divider line between the two lots to both accommodate the changes to the zoning and to accommodate the current layout plan. And with that, try to keep it brief. We're certainly open to any questions that you may have. As I mentioned, one of the things that is critical on all of this is timing and schedule. And we are planning, hopefully, trying to start construction this fall. Will and the rest of the architectural team at Sims Maney have already started building design so that we can advance to the building building permit stage on this quickly. And while we need to go at full speed to meet schedule, it is a very long and lengthy process because once the shell of the building is built, there's a long time to fit out all the detailed lab equipment and production equipment inside, very, very complicated interior construction. And then there's a validation and certification process that you have to go through to bring the service online. Think of it, of course, anything, you know, medical oriented has a lengthy certification process. So right now, as we understand it, the expectation is that this would be brought online probably in late 2022 to early 2023. But our obligation is to deliver that shell of the building by starting this fall and constructing through the winter and delivering it as early as possible next spring and summer.
Well, thank you, gentlemen, very much for that presentation. I will ask board members if you have questions. Please feel free. And I can't see everyone. If you, Tony, can you see all the members? I'm not sure if anyone has their hands up. I can't see. Let me just scroll down a little bit. There we go. Now I can see people. Any questions by board members for the applicant? Sean?
Yeah. So first of all, thank you for sending in that response today to the DPW concerns, because it actually addressed a lot of my questions. Can we talk about that area that is, it has the two crosswalks kind of a little bit to the right of center and a little bit centered. I don't know how best to refer to it, but you look at the building and you go, right about, if you take the cursor, the hand, you move it right over there. Talk some about the visibility in that area and if you're going to put any signage up to help mitigate potential, you know, collision points there.
Yep. So that's a really good question. And maybe, Will, maybe you can zoom in a little bit on the front there. That would be good. A couple of items to point out. We are looking to add a sidewalk across the property along Bedford Woods Drive, which continues a sidewalk that exists today but terminates at the end of the FW website. So we're going to continue that and bring that up further. And also, given the geometry that you have there and the fact that it's a wooded site today, if you were pulling out of a driveway at that location, it would probably be difficult to see far in either direction. So one of the things we were doing, there are some nice street trees along that edge of Bedford Woods Drive today that are attractive and fairly mature. So we've talked about keeping those in place, but making sure that they are trimmed below 5 feet in height so that any vehicle pulling out will be able to see under the canopy in that area. And other than that, behind that, we'll have the sidewalk and it will be some parking areas that are clear. So you'll have a very good visibility in both directions as a result.
Okay, thank you. That definitely answers my question. How about bicycle parking? Where are you planning for that to be?
Yeah, I think Will is circling with his cursor an area where we have some bicycle parking proposed. There is discussion about having an employee entrance on that side of the building. Some of the building details are still being worked out, but the idea would be to have some bicycle park or the bicycle parking located there. Haven't confirmed this, but I know that there's the opportunity maybe to dedicate a parking space for additional bicycle parking, and we're looking into that as well. But at this point, we're meeting the requirements by having the bike parking in the plaza just on the southwest side of the building there.
Okay. And I think I saw on your plan, are those going to be the hoop type bike racks? The ones that look like a circle coming up from the...
Yeah, I think that's what we had shown in spec at the moment.
Okay. And then my last question for now, looking ahead, do you have any idea of when the next phase might be proposed?
So we're not with Ultragenics, obviously, and I know that they're very interested in the ability to have and to be able to go to that next phase quickly. But I can't tell you at this point in time whether it's going to be, you know, two days, 2 years, or 10. But I know that they're very, it was a deciding factor in locating here in Bedford and at this site in Bedford Woods, is that ability to expand is extremely important.
Okay. Thank you. That's all I got for now.
Thank you.
Amy?
This is just questions, right?
Yes.
Okay. One question I had, you answered several already. The strip of street trees, the semi-mature street trees, it looks to me like it's very hard for my plan set to measure the scale, that it's only about 15 feet and the sidewalk would be a part of that 15 feet. Do you know the measurement specifically? I'm concerned about the root system, particularly with the warming and drying summers that we've been having and their longevity making such a big impact to their environment.
Will, do you have that dimension from in there?
Sure, I can pull up the screen. Our landscape architect has been keen to this strip of landscaping from the get-go. And that's why we did, there was a lot of back and forth on the alignment of that. On the alignment of this walkway, wanting to preserve those trees here because they are in very good shape. So that's why we do have the sidewalk as far over against the parking as possible and not, meandering throughout this paved way. So these parking spaces are 16 feet wide. Sorry, this is not very scientific.
So that's looking like 12 feet is the...
So the entire...
The green island, space.
The green space is probably...
It looks like about 12.
Okay.
Yeah, that sounds about right. And I would say that the... trees that are out there today are probably about, I don't know that we've measured all of them, about 5 feet off the Bedford Woods site drive curb. So they'll end up roughly in the center of that area.
They're almost in line with these light poles, which are surveyed. They're all kind of in alignment.
So no, I saw them. No, I was out there. I saw them. And your landscape architect is comfortable with that amount of space given to their root systems?
Yes.
Okay. And the other question I had was, is in the building design, are you providing, I guess this isn't technically site plan, but are you providing indoor, obviously indoor shower facilities for bikers and runners?
Right. So I don't know the full interior build out program as of yet. Again, that's sort of being refined and defined as we talk right now to confirm. I know that there are locker rooms planned. I'm not 100% sure about shower facilities and okay. How that's being handled.
Okay, thank you. That's all my questions.
Thank you.
Cindy?
Hi. Thanks to Sean and Amy for pointing some things out already. Along the lines of the biking, so we do like to promote multimodal transportation as much as possible. So it is kind of important in suburban park settings like this to be able to have the shower facilities in the building. So that's just something you can think about to iterate to your client. And the other thing along those lines is, I know the Gutierrez company is involved, an organization member of Middlesex 3, but we need to encourage your clients to also be a member of the TMA for the organization as well.
Understood. Yeah, I mean, we've been big supporters of the TMA, of Middlesex 3, and definitely understand the desire for support for transportation management efforts.
Right. Thank you. That's all.
Any other questions, Steve? Any questions on your end?
First, I have to unmute. No, I drove the site today, and I've actually been to RSA a few times. I had to give talks there. So I was actually, since I'm on CONSCOM also, I was trying to look at it from both points of view. Mostly it's because Tony did such a good job writing it up. I'd read the material that the applicant has put in, and then Tony wrote it up so well. I said, geez, I got nothing to say. However, since I sit on CONSCOM also, and I know you're appearing there at our next meeting, the question you're going to get, so I'll ask it here, and then because you wrote it up quite eloquently, it's your snow storage plan. That's given that the wetlands on the other side of the road, they'll still say, but where's the snow being put? Because there's been not you guys, other offenders in the town of Bedford where they just plowed the snow off into the woods or whichever, and action had to be taken. You've got a much better plan, but perhaps you could describe that, you know, in 30 seconds or so.
Sure. And that was one of the questions as well from DPW, and Will and his team helped put together a snow storage plan as well. But for the most part here, there are some island areas and the like that would be used for snow storage, as Will is starting to highlight as well. Some of the areas off the back of the site would be used for snow storage as well. And, if you get the Armageddon snow type conditions, what ends up happening is we do sacrifice some areas within parking lots, because typically when you have that much snow on that time frame, then you don't always have everybody arriving at work as well. So we have been able to work that way. So there are a number of different snow storage areas, and then beyond that, we do, you know, again, the Armageddon type events, you look at trucking snow offsite and things like that. But we do know not to plow it into the wetlands and the like, and we've arranged such for all of our properties.
No wetlands and no detention basins.
No detention basins, that's right. Thank you, Will.
All right, thank you, Steve. I'll admit, Scott, I have not read your responses to DPW's comments in their entirety. Were there any comments there that were, I guess you didn't, or you took exception to, or were going to need further clarification, or were problematic in your eyes?
So there was nothing there we take exception to. They're all actually very good comments. Had a good conversation with both fire department and DPW. I guess the one thing that is still will need to be resolved, which is the water and sewer connections. So Ultragenics has a plan that will phase in some operations over the years, again, starting in late 22 or early 23. They will need sewer capacity for that. Actually, when they first open up, they may not need it, but shortly thereafter, if they expand and grow their operations, they anticipate needing additional sewer capacity. So the town's consultant is, the town's DPW sewer consultant is right now evaluating that longer term planning. And so any water and sewer needs that are going to be defined by DPW will need to be implemented if there's some mitigation or upgrades required. But I think that is a longer term plan and may even involve future expansion.
Okay, thank you for that.
Yep.
Any questions for Catherine or Tony, staff? Any questions, anything we need to cover? I do see, Tony, you have drafted a decision, and there were 14, I guess, conditions that you've enumerated. I just wanted to go through them and let the applicant know about them. I don't know if they have been already had been shared with the applicant or not, but I just wondered if staff had any other questions or comments.
Was that in our meeting packet?
No, that was an email late today.
Oh, I didn't see that yet. Okay.
Yeah, so
I don't have it either, sorry.
Yeah, so I have talked about these with Scott. And there are a couple of edits they would like, which I have no objection to.
Is there a way that that can be put up on the screen so the other members can see what those are, Tony? Because these will be the conditions that we are going to place on our decision here.
Right. So does that clear? I can't tell what you see.
Oh, we can see it.
That's good.
Right.
See the first page.
Yeah, we can see the first page and 1 through 3 for the recommended conditions.
So there's they'd ask for a quick change in how. So as written here, number one simply says we're recommending approval of phase one, acknowledging there's a phase two. Number two says, you know, if the DPW analysis of water and sewer identifies issues or fire department's concern about water pressure for fire suppression systems, there'll be some agreement between the town and the applicant to get those done, and they'll be done before the building is occupied.
Okay.
Number three gets back to just the specific pipe size, which is the connection between the water main and the building for specific to fire service, which is not related to the domestic feeds that would come in for the consumable water, but
right,
very specific to fire sprinkler systems.
Mm-hmm.
The chief also wants to have the final say, which is very common to have a final say in where the hydrants are around the building. Some theoretical locations have been designed, but they'll reserve the right during construction to say, gee, you know, if we really want to move it from this island to another island, they'll have the ability to do that.
Tony, could you zoom in just a little bit more?
Can I?
There we go.
Yeah, I don't know if I can.
Oh, okay, no, that's fine.
I guess I'm not sure I can make it any. Well, let me try this.
There you go. Yeah, that's working.
There were some questions about some of the conditions of some of the existing catch basins, like some of them have hoods or snouts over the outlets, and whether we want to make they're functioning properly. So we've asked for a pre-construction survey of the drainage system to identify any repairs that need to be made. a drainage maintenance, excuse me, the operations and maintenance plan was submitted yesterday, which looks good for a preliminary review. So just a reminder that the future maintenance of the system has to comply with that plan. Snow management plan has been submitted. We just need to wait. We'll get some confirmation from DPW that it's acceptable. And actually, it'll also be reviewed next week at CONCOM. So we really won't know till after that meeting.
Okay.
Requirement that Conservation Commission approval be given for that section of the construction, which is mostly where the driveway meets the, how do I say this, the main driveway and the first curb cut into the site essentially is where, that's where most of the jurisdiction is. Most of the construction of the building is outside the CONCOM jurisdiction. We noted all the bicycle parking is at the one corner of the building. Internally, we were talking about whether or not, you know, could one or two of the bike racks be moved closer to the front entrance. I'm not sure we have to solve that today. It's maybe just something to look at. Mm-hmm. And as the, you know, as Ultragenics thinks about how that front space is going to be used, maybe there's a way to put one or two of the one or two of the hoops out there,
or an additional entrance, as Scott mentioned.
Yeah, or at other entrances. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
There's already Bedford Woods already has a physical emergency access out to Noreen Drive, which connects out to Old Billerica Road. There has been discussion in the past and continues with this about creating a second emergency access, this connecting through to Oak Park Drive. There is an existing easement on the property to the property line. We are looking at that and going to start talking to the abutters on the Oak Park side to see about getting reciprocal easements on that side of the property line to create another emergency access only. That might actually be more important to Oak Park because it only has one way in and out and there's no emergency back door at Oak Park, where there is an emergency back door for Bedford Woods.
Mm-hmm. Talking about the TDM plan.
Yeah, so there was a, there's a typo in here, but I've fixed that out. There was a TDM plan as part of the original review where in 1999, the planning board issued a special permit for parking higher than the maximum ratio. Elements of that TDM plan are still reasonably applicable, but other things have evolved in the intervening nearly 20 years, or been 20 years since 99 anyway. And so we just wanted to make a note that, you know, there is the Middlesex 3 TMA. Bedford is also technically part of the Route 128 Business Council TMA. The MBTA bus literally comes into RSA security and deadheads there before turning around and heading back to Alewife Station in Cambridge. And the Lowell bus now runs Route 14 up and down Middlesex Turnpike. Mm-hmm. From past discussions, I don't think they're going to ever turn into here because they're on a very quick, jump on, jump off system. But
tight schedule.
But having the two, you know, two transit systems are here, and there's a TMA that can help also provide alternatives to everybody driving themselves. And so, as Cindy mentioned, it would be good that Ultragenics join the Middlesex 3 TMA at some point in the future.
Okay. Could you please scroll down a little bit, Tony, so we can see number 14?
Yeah, and then...
There's no more 14.
Well, I think there is because I've added... one about just a crafts reference to the fact that there's also an A&R. So the lot lines on this site plan are based on the A&R plan that's being reviewed at the same time.
Okay. So has this, as what we're looking at now, because I see there are some changes and differences in what is up on the screen versus the hard copy that I have. So, and I'll ask Scott simultaneously, have you gone through and where are the, I guess, items that were, you had some thoughts on or comments on or concerns about? Have they been now addressed and are reflected in what we're seeing?
It looks to be that way. Yes. We provided a few limited comments. I haven't gone through in detail what you have there, Tony.
This is actually what I put on the screen is your redline version.
Okay. So then, yeah, I guess it's got it. When I say I haven't gone through in detail, I couldn't see some of the items, but yeah, it looks to have the comments that we've addressed. And ours were pretty limited in terms of just acknowledging the recognition for the parcel size and development capacity. Mm-hmm. That's an important item for the future expansion potential for Ultragenics. And then, as Tony mentioned, just clarifying the language as to the water and sewer requirements and timing for those improvements. So the item number 14 that you mentioned, I don't know that we had seen that either, but if it's just to cross-reference the correct property lines, that we would have no objection there.
Okay. Tony, could you go back up to the top items 1, 2, and 3 again, please, just quickly, because I did have one question or comment about any infrastructure or DPW. So it says, okay, prior to issue, so my copy had, so now it's number 2, completed prior to issuance of any occupancy permit, whereas before it said something about prior to issuance of any framing permit and completed prior to issuance of any occupancy permit. I was curious about framing permit and thought it should be building permit, but I see that's been taken out now.
One of our concerns about this was just the timing issue, and again, as our ability to move forward and begin construction, and recognizing that Ultragenics, even use of the building, will be phased in over time after the 2022-23 timeframe. There may be no immediate need to upgrade sewer or water systems, but it may be something that needs to be done going forward into the future. So certainly need to have anything in place prior to occupancy permit that you need for them to operate, but there may be upgrades that continue on beyond that timeframe. So we're certainly agreeable to having those obligations be recognized here and hammered out with DPW as they define the needs of the system.
Okay. Thank you for that clarification. I understand that. That makes total sense to me.
Jeffrey, can I ask a question?
Certainly, Steve.
I just want a clarification on item 12. This is the bus stop shelters. And I want to just ask Scott, are you reading that to say that you are committing to put in at least one bus stop shelter on that site that's handicap accessible, has a roof? I ask partly because the Board of Health of Bedford has now adopted this. We have 2 bus stop shelters already installed around town and 2 more on their way. So with a new construction of this size, plus the fact that you're going to be on a bus stop line, I would ask, are you reading item 12, Scott, as saying, yes, you commit to put in a bus stop shelter?
That is a good question. That wasn't our reading that we were committing to put a bus stop shelter in. I have to confirm, I'm not entirely sure, but I thought there are at least 1, if not 2, bus stop shelters already on site, too. Thank you.
Well, site, you mean up by RSA. That doesn't mean in front of this building.
That is correct.
With a bus stop, a handicap access shelter, you need it on in front of this building.
That is correct. And we did not have that included at this point. And I would just want to confirm with Ultragenics if it makes sense, because one of the things on this is their, you know, workforce and access to be able to use the MBTA. But in general, you know, that is something for good future planning. If not, we could at a minimum put one just up the road, basically splitting lots one and two, so it could serve both buildings.
Oh, but still part of the lot one and two project, not the RSA work.
That's correct. Yeah, right? Splitting the two future, you know, currently undeveloped lots. Yes.
But that would mean that you're not committing to have it be part of this project, because that could be waiting for lot two then.
No, we can commit to do it now.
Thank you. If the minutes could show that, please, Jeffrey.
Yep. Yeah. I think we can just make a modification to number 12 to reflect that also. Scott, if you're amenable to that.
Yeah, we will commit to providing one. We just want some flexibility on the location so we can
coordinate
it with Ultragenics.
Okay. Yep. No, thank you very much for that. We appreciate that. All right. So are there any other questions, any comments from the board, or I guess are we ready to deliberate on this? Amy, go ahead.
Well, I have comments.
Okay.
Well, in general.
Why don't we go into comments then?
I like that you've located the building closer to the road, so that it's not surrounded by a sea of asphalt, but there is quite a lot of asphalt between plantings, and one of my concerns is the lack of shade trees. There are only 15 shade trees in your planting plan, and the rest are ornamentals and shrubbery. I would like to see a greater emphasis on trying to provide shade and enough root space for those trees, because like I had said before, our summers are getting hotter and drier, and it's going to become more and more of a problem with the heat. So anything that can be done to mitigate that, to deal with water runoff, et cetera, is, I think, beneficial. I mentioned the shower facilities, and I would like, if possible, I realize you want to discuss this with Ultragenics, but I'd like to see some enhanced bicycle storage, something covered perhaps. It's certainly been my experience having a number of friends and family in the sciences and engineering that biking culture is very strong there, and they typically have good bikes that they want to take care of and keep undercover. I realize that Bedford's rules around bike is fairly minimal. And I think that they're really written for somebody running to the grocery store on their bicycle and wanting to lock it up outside temporarily, not someone who's a bicycle commuter. And that really is to your advantage as you compete with the city facilities. Today, you have Ultragenics, but that might not be the case 20 years from now. And being able to compete in amenities is a benefit to you as well. I did want to ask if there were any other outdoor amenities planned. I see a couple of cafe tables outside the front entrance, and I do see a sidewalk around, which I applaud, and the sidewalk along the road I applaud. Do you have any other amenities planned? Any picnic table areas, basketball court, anything like that?
Not associated with this project. There is the outdoor patio area, as you mentioned, and the sidewalk is really all that we are proposing directly on site. I know the site is also fairly close and has access, obviously, sidewalk access down to Middlesex Turnpike and some of the other trail systems that are adjacent. And I believe it's the O'Connor reservation yep. area just to the north. So there isn't anything further proposed on site.
I realize you're trying to gallop ahead with this, and I certainly understand. Is that more of a possibility when you start moving into phase two? that perhaps there can be some site amenities, a walking path, a pavilion for people to sit and take their laptop outside.
Is for, you know, phase two that could consist of a lot of different configurations that I don't think has been defined yet. And that'll be really dependent on Ultragenics and their needs as they go forward. And is something that we can look at a little bit further on lot two.
You are open to the discussion once we start talking phase two.
Sure.
Okay. And then the other thing I had was, Steve covered the bus shelter. Are the street lights, you make a distinction between pedestrian lights and street lights on the plan. Are the pedestrian lights like bollards?
Yeah, the idea near the entrance area, mm-hmm. you would have some more decorative bollard style lighting as opposed to the overhead fixtures.
Okay.
Scott, I think parking lot lights are the more traditional lights with the arms coming out of them. The pedestrian levels, I believe, are supposed to be the more kind of ornamental 12-foot high size, not necessarily bollards.
We require full cutoff, and I would encourage you to think and design very, very carefully around your lighting for with dark sky provisions in hand.
And Scott, yeah. I'm sorry to interrupt, but comment about Amy had about the additional trees. Is there an opportunity to incorporate more trees in the landscape?
And just to comment on the lighting, just all of our parking lot lighting fixtures are always full cutoff, fully recessed type fixtures. We've made that a corporate change it feels like many years ago now. So that is how we do. They are all LED at this point as well. And I think we'll work with Will and the design team so that the more decorative fixtures, pedestrian scale lighting, is also then a dark sky compliant. On the landscaping question, I know given the type of facility it is and some of the concerns with the activities in there, it's very important to Ultragenics to keep a very clean and sort of pest-free perimeter around the building. And one of the things, you know, that leads to a little bit of why, you know, the detention basin is also moved further towards the edge of the site. It is very critical that is a very tight and well-maintained perimeter. I think in some of the other islands and areas, I didn't go through and count them up, but I felt like we had more than 15 shown, and maybe some of them were, as you said, were noted as shrubs and not trees, and maybe we can look into Will modifying those locations so that they are more actual trees and provide some shade.
Well, I was looking at the variety of trees, and 15 of them are shade trees and the rest are ornamental or shrubs. I understand that the arborvitae are screening, the generator equipment, and I have no objection to that. But like on the sort of the Middlesex Turnpike side parking lot, the row of trees along the parking, dividing part the parking strip are all ornamentals. And not shade trees. And there's a root system issue. I understand that. But I think that 15 shade trees, there's only two honey locusts, there's a couple of sweet gum, isn't enough for a site of this size, particularly given the fact that it's a mature maple forest. Now, it's a pretty significant change. And again, I support this development wholeheartedly. But I think that there's opportunity to look at shade and try to create as much as possible. And a shade tree has a clean underneath. So I understand Ultragenics has specific needs, and I think we can certainly comply with them.
Yeah,
we'll feedback back to our landscape architects, and I'm sure they can implement those
Yeah, certainly along that strip in the middle of the parking spaces on that sort of first front parking lot, we can look at those there. That is one location to provide some additional shade, and then we can look at all the other plantings around the site and look to be more shade oriented. I don't know how that works in conjunction with some perhaps being evergreen, so that you get some color and shading year round as well.
All right.
Yeah, that doesn't matter. Thank you, Jeff. That's all the comments I had. Thank you. Okay.
Anyone else comments? Any other members comments? Okay. All right. I fully support the development as well. And I think we're ready to move into motions at this point then. We'll vote on them separately. So I guess we will start with the A&R.
I will move that the approval not required be verified by the planning board.
Second.
Okay, motion by Mr. Hannigan, second by Ms. Lloyd. We'll do a roll call vote on that. Start with Mr. Hannigan.
Yes.
Ms. Barbahan.
Yes.
Ms. Lloyd.
Aye.
Mr. Hagan.
Yes.
And myself, aye. So that carries 500. Excuse me. And now looking at the question about recommending approval for the site plan of modification to the site plan or amendment to the site plan with the conditions that we've discussed. Is there a motion on that item?
So moved.
Okay. Is there a second?
A second.
Okay. Motion by Ms. Barbahan, second by Mr. Hannigan. Roll call vote on that. Mr. Hannigan?
Aye.
Ms. Barbahan?
Aye.
Ms. Lloyd?
Aye.
Mr. Hagan?
Aye.
And Mr. Cohen, aye. That carries unanimously 500 as well.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome, and thank you very much. We look forward to seeing this project take form, and would appreciate the follow-up on the landscaping with staff. And we wish you well and good luck with your project.
Yeah, thank you. And just to say, very well run. I know it's difficult to do this online, and very thoughtful comments. You guys did your homework, so we appreciate that as well. So thank you. Well,
thank you very much. Good luck.
Thank you. It was a pleasure. Have a good night.
Thank you. You too. All right. The next item on our agenda. Tony,
can I interrupt?
Sure.
Just on logistics.
Mm-hmm.
For the A&R plan, which you would normally be signing in a physical meeting, do you want to set it up that at least three of you swing by the office to endorse, or you can delegate, you can authorize one member to sign on behalf of the entire board?
I'm available to swing by the office if two others would like to join me, or I'm happy to act on behalf of the board.
It need not be at the same time. It just three of you would need, a majority of the board would need to sign at some point so it can be recorded.
Mm-hmm. Or we could delegate to Jeffrey. If Jeffrey's ready to go in, we could delegate it to him right now. Is that what you're saying, Tony?
That is also an option. You could vote to delegate to the chair the ability to sign A&Rs on behalf of the board during this pandemic.
Are the other members okay with that as well?
I'm fine with that.
We can do it as a one-off, not as a blanket statement, though. Maybe.
I'm sorry, Cindy. What was...
Can we just do it as a one-off and not just as a blanket statement for?
Of course.
Going forward? Yeah. Okay.
Yep. So, Tony, when would that be ready for me to come in and sign? Is that the plan that you have on file?
I don't have the Mylar here because we were waiting to confirm if we needed to make any amendments to it.
Okay.
So it'll be a day or two.
Okay.
We'll be in touch.
All right. That sounds good.
Okay. So we're ready to move. Can I move?
we are ready to move on to the next item.
No, can I move that we vote?
Oh,
we
have I'm sorry. Go ahead. Yep, absolutely.
So move to delegate Jeff Cohen to sign for the members of the other members of the board for the A&R for lots 1 and 2 of Bedford Woods.
Second. Okay, motion by Ms. Lloyd, second by Mr. Hagan to permit me to sign on behalf of the board. Roll call vote, Ms. Barbahan. Cindy, you're muted.
Aye.
Mr. Hannigan?
Aye.
Ms. Lloyd?
Aye.
Mr. Hagan?
Aye.
And I guess I'll say aye. So that's unanimous. So Tony, I'll be waiting for your call. All right, now I think we're ready to move on to the next item on our agenda. We are being asked to make a recommendation to the Select Board on an Aquifer Protection District special permit application, replacement of emergency generators and associated fuel storage tanks at 202 Burlington Road. The MITRE Corporation is the applicant. And is a representative of the applicant
there
won't, here?
There's no one here from MITRE.
There's no one here for that?
No.
Okay. So what are we, how do we proceed here? If people look through the material, I guess, who do we ask questions of, Tony, then? Or is this just a discussion amongst ourselves?
Yeah. So if you have questions, ask them and I can get them relayed or I may be able to answer them.
Okay. Amy, you see your hands up?
It might surprise you that I have a question. looking at the list of the storage items, there are just two things that jump out at me as potential problems. One, the fourth one down is a container behind building number 6. There are 5-gallon pails behind a building stored in the exterior of miscellaneous oils, which sound to me like it could be waste oil. But my concern is just, if there are 5-gallon buckets sitting out beside the parking lot, they could get backed into or something. And so just verification that they're stored in such a way that they can't accidentally be hit and spilled. And then the other one down close to the bottom, AST is the type. There's a temporary diesel fuel tank with 500 gallon capacity of diesel fuel that's contractor owned and operated. And I'm wondering if MITRE inspects that, if who has oversight over that particular one. Those are the only two things that jumped out at me. Otherwise, I applaud them getting rid of their underground tanks.
Mm. Okay. All right. Any other members have questions? Sean, please.
Sure. So let me just start off by saying I was actually an employee of MITRE for about 13 years, ending in 2014. And I did check with staff on this one. And because my employment ended so long ago and I don't have anything like stock in the company, there's no conflict of interest that would require me to recuse. That having been said, I mean, I do applaud them for, moving their underground tanks above ground. I did find it to be a little bit strange in the package that was produced. It said, essentially, we can't tell you where they're going to be located because of security reasons, which, I mean, MITRE does do some classified work, but unless I'm reading that wrong, it struck me as kind of strange because if they're constructing these things above ground, it's not going to be a secret where any of this is. And I actually had some of the same concerns that Amy did, depending on the location, is it really going to be shielded? I know in their campus, they have interior roads. They actually have a kind of a piece of the Middlesex Turnpike that goes around baseball fields that they own or softball fields. So it would give me a better sense if I knew where on the campus these were going and maybe a schematic of what they were looking like. But in general, I approve of the concept.
Amy, another question?
Sorry, I just had one more thought that, again, this is, since this is a recommendation for the selectmen, something that they might request. I understand if they want to have heightened security and not talk about the location. It mentioned that the fire department was completely briefed and knowledgeable, but it occurred to me that the health department should also have that information, even if it's not widely disseminated. But the health department is an integral part of hazardous material storage as well. So that would be a recommendation I would want to make to the selectmen to request that as well. Thanks.
So Sean, are your comments, and I guess what I'm trying to figure out is, are these just questions and concerns that we would relay to the selectmen for their review?
Is that I think that makes sense, because they're the special permit granting authority. So
right.
I would just relay that they would at least ask the question of why we can't know the location, just because we are concerned about where it might be with regards to vehicular traffic or, you know, perhaps entertainment type things, because I know that there are places on the campus where they have regular soccer games, they have regular softball games. I don't think it's enough for us to hold this up, though, at this point.
Mm-hmm. Hey, Tony, have you been taking notes on these questions?
Yes.
Okay, and concerns? I agree. I think it's, you know, like, to be applauded that they're going to be putting these above ground. I think they're very good questions, too, that you're bringing up. So any other questions, members? Might have. Okay. So it sounds like, I mean, is it that we're, I guess, recommending? So Tony, are we recommending approval? What is it that we're recommending? We're recommending, I've always wondered about this one, that they, I mean, we have questions, we applaud that they're removing the underground tanks, but there are some things we would like to have them bring up with the applicant in there.
So let me draft a memo and I'll get that distributed, that kind of gets into that, you know, that the board's philosophically supportive of what's intended here, but has some technical questions on location and how that location impacts, you know, traffic, you know, what's the view, are there locations where there's vehicle impact to worry about or leaks to the drainage system or anything like that? So we can raise those as items to try to force them to map more clearly where these are.
Okay. Okay. That works for me. Any other, so is that fine with all with the other members as well? We'll move forward in that way.
Yes.
Okay. Then in that case, it looks like we can move on to our business session and review of committee assignments and liaison assignments. Does everybody have that? Tony, do you want to put that up on the screen or for people to see? Thank you very much. So in this new world we're living in, there haven't been a lot of other meetings, but at some point when we do get back to business, we will need to have relationships with these boards. So, you know, I know we've made some minor adjustments in the past, and now that Mark is no longer a member and we have Steve, I guess I will throw it open to the board about how they feel about their assignments, if they would like to seek other liaison assignments. And you know, Steve,
perhaps I could go first since I have no assignments at all. and I'm meeting all the obligations too. So I'm on the Conservation Commission, and Siegenthaler's gone, so I'd suggest that that I do that one. I'm also on the Depot Park Advisory Committee, so I could suggest that I could represent us there. and then I leave it to others. Second thought, we have the Hanscom Area Towns Committee. It's not a pop. Let's just say I've been it before as part of CONSCOM. I can do that if you like. Yeah, I will leave that to others. Maybe other people are eager to go join that committee. But surely CONSCOM and Depot Parks, I'm on those anyways. And then I will be quiet and see what other people would like to send my way or not send my way.
Okay. Sean, you're currently with Depot Park.
I'm happy with my assignments. I know actually Cindy is also with Depot Park, so it probably becomes an issue if three of us carry Depot Park. If Cindy and Steve want to do it, I'm fine in not doing it. I am curious about it. I'd probably just keep tabs on it, but I wouldn't necessarily be an official person.
Okay.
Cindy, did you want to keep doing that?
I haven't been terribly active in that one, but I'm kind of waiting for some things to happen too there. So I don't know. If you still want to do it, Sean, go ahead and do it.
It's really a very simple one because there's basically one meeting a year in October. They have their annual meeting in the rail car.
Depot Park?
Yeah.
Maybe I'm confused on what we mean by committee. I'm on the board. There's three of us. Myself, Joe Piantedosi, and Jim Shea.
Oh, okay.
And so we meet fairly regularly.
Yeah, you're talking about the actual board, which is definitely more in depth than the advisory committee.
Oh, I thought that's what we were talking about here. So I'm not sure what the advisory committee actually is then.
The advisory committee literally is, meeting once a year and just kind of keeping tabs on things. But if you're going to the actual board meetings, I haven't been going to those because they're typically during the day. That's fine with me that you become the official planning board.
Yeah, thank you. I go to those regularly, right?
Okay, that would seem to make a lot of sense then. Can we drop Depot Park Advisory Committee from both Sean and Cindy? Or Sean, do you want to?
No, that's fine with me. I'll probably just keep going to the annual one just out of my own interest, but I don't need to be official planning board there. If Steve is more in depth than I was anyway, so I'm glad to have him have it.
Okay, that sounds good. I guess then the HATS committee, Steve, would you be willing to do that? I'm just not familiar with.
I'm willing to do it. I will probably not be a regular attendee. I've been to several of their meetings. It depends if this is recorded or not. I could give you my comment about what the value of them is. It's valuable that Bedford as a town goes, but it's the selectmen that really represents us. There's a selectman that goes to it was Mark, was Rosenberg. So he and I used to go because I would go, he asked me to go and I'd be CONSCOM plus whatever. Mm-hmm. But basically, the towns meet, they discuss things relevant to the airbase and relevant to the commercial thing. And there's a CONSCOM issue because wetlands go right through part of the field. And so that comes up almost every year. Mm-hmm. But basically, the voting members, the selectmen. So whoever this is, if it's me, then I can go. But you just sit there and you wait patiently for the meeting to be over. If there's anything on a wetland issue, then I speak up as CONSCOM, but that's about it. So if somebody wants to steal this meeting from me, it'd be okay. But I will go if nobody else wants it.
So how do other members feel about that? I've just not had any experience with it myself.
Well, after that rousing support, Steve, I'm
not exactly. Hey, you're not a selectman. This isn't much fun.
Amy?
Well, actually, Steve, you're not going to like this, but it seems to me that since Mike Rosenberg has left the selectmen, I don't know which selectman has stepped into his shoes with hats, right. But you have institutional knowledge and CONCOM knowledge and overlap. And it seems to me that you're a good person to be the liaison, because even if we do have a selectman, you can liaise with them potentially. And it might be valuable that you have experience there.
I fully understand that.
Steve, when do they meet?
Now, obviously, I'm saying, yes, I'll do it if nobody else wants it. But then the easy counter and argument like that is, well, I should not be the only repository of this knowledge. We need to spread it around.
When do they meet, Steve?
Once you go to this, you won't want to do it. So we're just put my name by it, and then because we got a lot of other committees you got to sort out yet.
Steve, when do they meet? What is it, during the day?
It's about quarterly. Yeah, usually it's at night. Fortunately, it's at night. Yeah, and so there's a selectman from each of the town goes, and they chit chat with each other about what's going on. Mostly, they talk about what's going on in each of their towns, mm-hmm. less than what's going on at Hanscom.
So the net zero.
I did hats for a couple of years, and I for that reason alone, it's valuable to see what everybody else in the surrounding adjacent communities are doing. I think it's important, and
that's why it's a selectman, because they chat about what selectmen are doing in the other towns. Yeah, but so be it. We need to get onto the other committees.
I mean, if you're unable to attend a certain times, I may be able to fill in with that on an as needed basis. I think also I could provide support on that, because I'm not sure what more work we have to do with the Net Zero Advisory Committee at this time that might fall off of my list. And if there are any more needs of that committee, that was not a very heavy lift. But I don't believe that there is ongoing work for that committee, at least not to my knowledge, in the foreseeable future.
Jeff, what about the School Space Needs Task Force? Is that still ongoing, or is that ended?
That's also ended as well.
I think the net zeros. I was having a discussion with someone the other day, and I thought that they produced their product. It was a report, and that was
right.
It right.
Yep. I'm just not sure if there was any other follow up that was coming down the pipeline, but I think it is. Mm-hmm. I think it has accomplished what it set out to do. Mm-hmm. So I can put me down for hats support as well. I too am fine with my other liaison assignments. I don't know how what other members.
The Community Garden Task Force needs to be taken off because it's done, and I am on the Ad Hoc Hartwell Road Committee, although that's going to be wrapping up. They'll be producing a report fairly soon, hopefully. It's a difficult meeting. It's one of the groups that does not, isn't meeting because of COVID regularly, but there's some activity happening. So I anticipate that it will be wrapping up fairly shortly. Mm-hmm. And the Land Acquisition Committee, just to give you an update, as you know, the Land Acquisition Committee preferred to not have, welcome me being there, but preferred to not have an official member of the planning board, or not as part of the charter, because they feel like they've been kind of burnt by other required committee members not attending. But they asked if I would become a regular committee member. I put in an application to the nominating committee. I haven't heard back yet. So I'm fine.
So they don't want a planning board member liaison, they would rather have you just be a member.
Yes.
Does that mean you can't tell us what you hear?
No. They don't want an official liaison that's required to be there because they have problems with quorum.
Yeah, the quorum, they've messed up the quorum many times.
They've had a lot of problems with that. And there was some committee that formerly, a long time ago, was a required part of their membership. And that committee, whoever it was, just never sent anyone. So they always had problems with quorum. So
okay,
they just rather me be a regular member, which is fine. And I'll let you know if I hear back from the nominating committee. Otherwise, I'm good with my committee assignments.
Yeah, we certainly would want to force ourselves on anyone.
Yeah.
Right. Cindy?
So, a couple of things. I don't see the housing partnership on this list anywhere. Does anybody have the housing partnership?
Yeah, I have that.
You have both? The trust and the partnership?
Right. So, they kind of overlap a bit, but the partnership, I'm a voting member, and then the housing trust, I'm not a voting member, and I don't always attend that unless it's something that I think is specifically planning related.
How often do the partnership meetings happen?
I would say maybe 6 times a year. I mean, they kind of have a mix of different people from different boards, so it's sort of, we find a date, but it's roughly every 2 months or so, at least before COVID.
Have you met since COVID?
No.
Do you have plans to meet anytime soon?
I don't think so. I know that there was a meeting that was scheduled in April, and then it got put off, and it never really got rescheduled.
Yeah. And the other question I had was also on Mark's list was, did somebody say something about the Energy Task Force? Is that...
Right. That was another one too.
Right. Somebody needs to pick that one up. But I, as far as my stuff goes, you can take me off of the depot thing. I am on the charter bylaw review, and I'm still looking, and I'm excited about it reconvening at some point in the future to do the bylaw thing. We only do the charter part, so I still want to do that. I'm flabbergasted that the Transportation Advisory Committee isn't active. I still want to do it. I don't know why we're not meeting. And the Bicycle Advisory Committee, same thing.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And the Bedford, the Healthy Task Force, I still, yeah. And yeah.
So do we know if the Energy Task Force, have they been meeting? I'm guessing they probably haven't.
Has anybody else done it besides Mark in the past?
I did it in the past.
Mm-hmm. I did it. I think I did it before Amy did it. So I guess I hesitate to commit to more assignments. I'm a little bit challenged right now, time commitment work wise, and I'm not sure that I can commit. But there may not be anything to commit to for a while, so I just not sure.
Does anyone else have an interest in that?
I mean, I have an interest, but I'm sort of in the same position as Jeff. I'm a little time constrained. So I definitely don't want to commit to that now.
Well, is that something we could potentially share among members and see, depending on scheduling, who could be available to attend?
Yeah, that makes sense.
We could. I always hate to do that only because I don't think it works very well.
Yeah.
You know, we don't have a selectman liaison, and other than Mark, you know, we didn't attend a lot.
Can I make a suggestion? If Steve, you've got two twofers, maybe it would be okay to do another one. And if you're already obligated to do those two already, so.
So which one?
Energy Task Force.
Yeah, I know this is going to sound impolitic. Can you tell me what they do that's useful lately? I've read about it for years, but as you all said, are they actively meeting and doing what?
I don't know that they're meeting right now.
Yeah. In that case, it's easy to put my name by it then. And if they meet, tell them to contact me.
I'll take it.
You will, Amy? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Does that cover everything? I think it doesn't. And I am going to try to attend more select board meetings. As the chair, I feel I really need to do that. So,
it's gracious of you, Jeffrey, but what, and again, I'm new to the board, but what do you think is happening at the selectmen that the planning board is not notified in advance to say, oh yeah, one of you guys ought to be at this meeting?
Yeah. I mean, so typically I would review the agenda and see if there is a planning related item or perhaps a business development related item.
Transportation item,
anything that might be within our wheelhouse, and then, you know, attend or call in to those meetings. It was a little more, I guess, a little more to do as we were approaching town meeting, and we had our ADU, and when we have zoning amendments on the table. I guess it could vary week to week whether attendance would be required or not.
Okay.
So,
does anyone know what's going on with fall town meeting this year?
I had some buzz that there might not be a fall town meeting, but just buzz.
I'd say I heard the same.
Yeah.
Yep, heard the same.
Okay.
Okay. So then I guess are we squared away with these committee assignments? I think we are. Tony, if you and our staff could circulate an updated list, that would be appreciated. And then, so we will move on to reports. Does anyone have a liaison report to report? If there's anyone... Hey, Amy.
Actually, I attended the selectman meeting last week. They were discussing their priorities. But it was a bit of an odd meeting, and they didn't seem to come out of it with a new list of priorities, just their existing list of priorities. I think there were maybe some things that were reordered, but it was a kind of a freeform discussion. So I expected to come to you with a list like they've usually had, but it wasn't clear to me at all what their priorities are. So I'm waiting to see if any documents are generated. But it seems like they just sort of kind of kept what they had. That seemed to be the end result.
Okay. Any others? I figured this would be pretty quick. All right. So why don't we go to staff updates? The development update chart. And Tony or Catherine, if you'd like to just kind of go through this, it looks like there's a lot of things, a lot of question marks, still waiting to hear back from people on things.
Yes, I think really the items that you've dealt with tonight were the main changes. Mm-hmm. There's still a couple of things being kicked around in the wings. Question over 330 South Road and possibly the Iovino yard on South Road may come mm-hmm. up. But no definite applications for anything at this point.
Okay.
Is there a chance that they would come to us before an application for a pre-discussion?
For the we always property? Suggest that. And if, as you know, that was done for 330 South Road. Right. As an initial discussion, there was hope that they would come back with a revised proposal, but I don't know whether that's going to happen.
Yeah, I'm led to believe they're going to go forward without your advice. But
so this 330 South Road you're talking about, Tony?
Yes.
So they would go to the selectmen, and the selectmen wouldn't have a recommendation from the planning board, or would we weigh in what our initial thoughts and concerns were?
I think they're trying to get on the agenda at the select board, but have not yet been able to do so, at which point I don't know if we would then be asked to provide comments or not. What I'm hearing, though, is that they are only looking to bring the main parcel in and not add the two smaller single family house lots, mm-hmm. which change, if you added those other lots, it changes how flexible you could be in the design. But at this point, they have not asked to come back to the board with any revisions, but more just asking to get in front of the selectmen. And I think probably preliminarily just to gauge their level of support. On the Iovino site, surprisingly, I did get to see a set of the concept plans today. But I'm not sure what their timeline is. And if there's no fall town meeting, that I think they're hoping there is a fall town meeting. But
is that would require a zoning amendment?
Yes, because assisted living is not an allowed use, mm-hmm. In either of the districts that property straddles. So,
okay.
So we'll see. I believe Pam Brown met with the town manager today, but I don't. I have not heard a report back just yet.
Okay, thank you. So now I know we've received we were awarded some grants recently, and I know there was a question. We were wondering what the next steps are. I think with the narrow gauge trail and
I know Lisa has dropped off this call now, which neither she nor I have a final scope to tell you exactly what's being done with that shared streets grant exactly. So mm-hmm. my understanding is that it may be paying for the some additional highlighting signals at various crossings of the narrow gauge, and I think perhaps even here closer to the Mudge Way intersection where the crosswalk leads to the library and the school.
Mm-hmm. Cindy, you have a question?
Yeah, well, I kind of the shared streets grant that they got is a completely separate deal. And it does have some electronic opponent parts that they asked for in the grant that would be electrifying the intersections at some of the things, improving some of the intersections along the narrow gauge, but it's not the same project at all. And it's the shared street stuff is focused all over town. It's not focusing on just the.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So could we perhaps get an update? Would Elisa be able to provide some, or once you have additional info to share, could you convey that?
Yeah, so we're trying to track down exactly what elements are in that grant. Mm-hmm. The project that we started over a year ago with MAPC appears to be on hold, which was a narrow gauge arts and culture project, but also trying to introduce some safety to the Pine hill crossing. I am, because that had to be a contract with the town manager's office, the town manager's office assumed control of the of contact, but they tell me that the it looks like Cindy got dropped off. I'm just waiting Cindy's for Cindy to get back up.
Yep, there she is.
I talked to Amy in the town manager's office yesterday, and she says MEPC says that it's on hold.
What is on hold? But it's on hold. The last I heard, it was on hold because of the town, not because of MEPC. So I don't understand.
I'm not sure either, because as I say, I am not the point person on behalf of the town. So,
but you are. You signed it. So the town manager should know. Can you talk to the town manager and find out? Or
I'm working on that, because as you know, even though yes, we wrote the grant and intended for me to be the point person, but I was displaced as the point person.
So who is the point person for this project?
So Amy Fidalgo is the point person.
Okay.
Anyway, and so yesterday she told me that it's on hold. But I'll try to find out more as to exactly what, because I didn't think it was all that, MAPC's part didn't seem to be all that heavy lifting, but we didn't really hear anything through the, whenever we last met was like November, and we didn't hear anything through the spring, so.
With regards to the other shared streets grant, I mean, the planning board's interested in it, rightly, because they want to know what's going on, but also it seems interesting that they're not calling the Transportation Advisory Committee to a meeting to help. Like, it's an advisory committee that the selectmen set up to help them advise them on transportation issues. So if there's any, and this is all happening without any of this committee work helping. So, you know, I don't know. I think it could be a better process if the committee was involved. Because those are the people in the community. They're in there and understand these places and how and how to bike them and how to walk them and stuff. They live in the community.
So Tony, can we get a little follow up, I guess, and try to
figure
out logistics and communication?
We'll try to get that, because most of that work was also done without we weren't asked to help them either. So. So I will try to, as I say, so I haven't seen what the actual scope of work is. So it's a lot of little things, but I don't know, other than the parklet in front of Ken's Deli, I don't know exactly what the other pieces are.
I could tell you off a little bit if you want to know now. There's supposed to be three different neighborhood communities that are piloted out for more bikeability with partitioned off lanes or other things. And then there's also those signalization, the main brunt of the money is for those signals they're touchless signals for the pedestrian crossings at the narrow gauge at Great Road, that crossing where right now you have to touch it to make it go. And so this would be somehow activated without touching because of COVID. It's not a great idea to be touching stuff. So so a couple of those things automated at that location on the Great Road, as well as Tony said, somewhere in Mudge on by where Davis hits Concord Road, a couple places too, I think. So yeah. And yeah, and there's some other stuff in there about the parklet and some other things.
Of curiosity, what is a parklet in front of Ken's Deli?
It's when you transform a parallel parking space into public realm opportunity space. So like a sitting area, a mini park, more restaurant seating.
So you lose the parking then?
Yeah, lose the parking. Yeah.
Okay.
You put that there instead.
If you drive through the middle of Lexington, I haven't been there for a while, but they've certainly had them there for a while.
Yeah. Well, and there's tons of them in every town now because they're all, because of COVID, they're all out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. Well, thank you very much. So I see in our chat session that Rick Rosen has weighed in and said that the town manager and select board have agreed not to have a fall town meeting unless there's an urgent need to do so. For example, if the schools need more money to deal with COVID. So I guess unless there's an urgent need, there will not be a fall town meeting. Mm. All right. So I guess before we get to minutes, I just wanted to point out also in our package was the first draft of the proposed site plan regulations for people to start to take a look at. And we're going to be discussing that at our next meeting. So we can get that on off of our plate and address that. Catherine.
Just another couple of work items that I thought I would mention. One is we've been asked to do the annual reports, so Kathy and I are going to have a draft of that as we usually do it. I spent some time commenting on some draft TDM ideas that are being put together by consultant Nelson Nygaard with money left over from the Tri-Town Transit study after Burlington dropped out. So this is being done for ourselves in Lexington. But so far, I think they need to read our bylaw and sort out how the structure of it would fit with that or how our bylaw would need to adjust. And also, I think they need to look a bit harder about the legal limits and get some clear advice on that.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, so we have the minutes of March 10th. 2022 review. Are there any comments from members on those minutes? Amy?
I had actually a number. On page one, it just seems prudent to, under others present, Chair Barbara Henn called the meeting to order in room H206 of Bedford High School. It just isn't clear where we were, and it was an unusual space, so it seems like we should mention that.
I thought I'd already inserted that. Have we not got the right version?
Maybe not.
It's not in my package either. Well, the hard copy. It may be in an updated electronic version, right. But it's not in the hard copy that I have.
There was a version that I made a lot of edits to, so maybe I've got the wrong one.
Just what Kathy had printed out for us.
If you've made a lot of edits, Catherine, should we look at that document instead and table these until the next time? Just I don't know how.
Because the one I've got does seem to include some things that I know I changed. Maybe I better just take it away and check what's going on.
Were there substantive changes and edits, Catherine?
Yeah.
Or?
Oh, sorry. I thought you were talking to me.
No.
The one I've got printed out, it has under others present, it says Chair Babin called the meeting to order at 7:30 in room H206. Is that what you've got?
That's what it says, yep.
Oh, right. So maybe it just needs a height of the...
of BHS.
Oh, right. Well, I've got Bedford High School in the heading, though.
Oh, I missed that.
So I think this is the correct version. It didn't have those in the original one. Right. Is that okay? Do you want me to put of the high school just for extra clarity?
I think it should. I personally think it should say of the high school, just because.
Yeah, we can do that.
That's where.
Yeah, I was just panicking that you got the wrong version. That's
not
okay.
That important.
Okay.
On page five, the very top line says Ms. Lloyd states that it allows for flexibility for the elderly, and I specifically was talking, careful to not sort of make promises solely that it's going to solve, that ADUs would solve the problem of elderly housing. So I don't think that I was being specifically calling out just the elderly. I have always stated that it allows flexibility for families as well as providing property owners with potential income. And then the next page.
Amy, do you have edits that you can forward to Jack and Catherine to?
Yes.
Okay.
I can.
Yep.
On page 6, a little more than halfway down, it says Member Lloyd suggests that none of this be mentioned at town meeting. And I think that gives an impression, we were talking about the state bills, and I think that gives an impression that we're trying to hide something, and that wasn't what the discussion was about. It was more of that potential legislation at the state level not be a part of the town meeting discussion because it could all change, and so it would just muddy the waters. So I basically made a sentence saying that.
I think that was actually clarified in the next sentence by Tony.
Yes, it was, right. So, but I just thought that the statement sounds like it's being secretive, and it wasn't. And then the last one was on page 8, toward the top, Member Lloyd adds as a caveat that public opinion, it says itself, I feel like it's more accurate to say public opinion alone should not be the reason to do or not do something. It certainly informs. So that was it.
Okay. Thank you. Any other members, other comments? Sean?
I only had one comment. It was regarding the, on page 2, where it talks about the school committee members. And I believe since this was before a town meeting, that Joanne Santiago was functioning as chairperson and Dan Brasgall as vice chairperson at the time of the meeting.
Yeah, I do recall that.
Yeah, you're right.
Okay. Anything else, Sean?
That's it.
Cindy, do you have anything?
No, I'm fine.
I did have a couple. And as soon as I find them. So on page 6, Mr. Cohen stated that based on $250 per square foot to build, I was going to ask that we insert a 1,000 square foot unit that would approximately a $250,000 assessment. So I just wanted to add that based on the size of the unit, it's a 1,000 square foot unit. The primary one, I think there was a typo on page 8 in the paragraph under, well, the paragraph where it said Planning Director Field states, there's a sentence, I think it's about the third line down, also should not that before this meeting. I think it's that should possibly be also should note that before this meeting. I think it's, that's just a minor typo there. And that was all I had. Other things I have are minor that I'm not even going to bother suggesting them. They don't change anything. So with that said, is there a motion to accept the minutes as amended?
I'm moved.
Okay. Motion by Ms. Lloyd, second by Mr. Hannigan to accept the minutes as amended. And so I think, Steve, you will be recused or abstaining because you weren't on the board yet. So, Mr. Hannigan, roll call vote. Ms. Lloyd. Ms. Barbahan. Ms. Cohen, aye. And Mr. Hagen is abstaining. So 401 on the minutes. And with that, looks like we've covered everything on the agenda. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All right.
Second.
All right. Motion by Mr. Hannigan, second by Ms. Lloyd to adjourn. Roll call vote, all in favor. Mr. Hannigan.
Aye.
Ms. Lloyd.
Aye.
Mr. Hagan.
Aye.
Ms. Barbahan.
Aye.
And Mr. Cohen. Aye. So thank you very much, everyone, staff, members, and everyone out there viewing this meeting. And good night.
Thanks.
Nice to see everyone, or at least your doppelgangers online. Your pixelated version. Good night.
Good night.